So we always come back because we're such proud alumni of Sunday school. So my name is Talma.
And I'm Rania.
And to begin, we'd like to ask our favorite guest, Abuna, to say a little prayer.
Thank you. Then Mandrania, let's stand in prayer. Heavenly Father, we heaven and earth rejoice in the birth of your Son, the Savior of the whole universe. Lord, we praise you, we thank you, for in such time, O Lord, your Son became flesh, and his glory shone over all the universe, when that we may behold his glory as the Son of the only begotten One, O Lord. Grant us to see his glory and glorify him together with the angels and cry out that Hosanna in the highest, glory be in heaven and all on earth peace. In Jesus' name we pray that your blessings may be showered on us tonight and the joy of your birth, O Lord Jesus, may fill our hearts. Grant that the kids, O Lord, may grow in your favor. May your blessings be always showered upon them. Protect them and bless them. Make them a blessing to the church and to the to Canada and to the whole universe. Bless us all and grant us to dwell together in the joy of the Lord. Praise you and offer you thanksgiving in Jesus' name and sing the Lord's Prayer and say, Avun Beshmai. Thank you.
Okay, so our first act is the grade 1 and 2s, Luna's class. So they will be singing What Shall I Give Him?
Give to you for Christmas.
That was an awesome performance. Next, we have some songs and verses from the JKSK class from Rajat, and they're going to be singing Sing Noel, Noel.
Christmas, all the tinsels and lights and the presents are nice, but the only gift is you. Happy birthday, Jesus. I'm so glad it's Christmas. All the carols and bells make the holidays well, but only about you. Happy birthday, Jesus, 'cause I love you.
Can you say your verse?
Today in Bethlehem, born a Savior is Christ the Lord.
You have a book?
The angel said, "Don't be afraid. I bring a good news for all people. A Savior is born to you.
Shall call his name is Emmanuel. That need God with us."
So backstage, our next performers are the grade ones and twos again, and they will be singing
Do You Hear What I Hear?
So let's give them a round of applause as they're preparing.
Thank you. what I see.
See what I see, way up in the sky, little lamb.
Do you see what I see?
Do you see what I see?
A star, dancing in the night, with a tail as big as a kite. With a tail as big as a kite. Said the little lamb to the shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear?
Do you hear what I hear?
Ringing through the sky, shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear?
Do you hear what I hear?
A song, high above the tree, with a voice as big as the sea. With a voice as big as the sea. Shepherd boy to the mighty king, do you know what I know? In your palace warm, mighty king, do you know what I know? A child shivers in the cold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Child sleeping in the night, he will bring us goodness and light. He will bring us goodness and light. Do you hear what I hear?
Do you
So our next play is by Soha's class, which are the grade threes and the grade fours. It's called Being Content. So give them a round of applause.
Our class of play is titled Being Content.
It revolves around a group of kids who get jealous of what their friends get for Christmas.
And how they learn a lesson being happy and satisfied with what they get.
Enjoy watching our play.
So girls, I was talking to your dad about you telling you what you wanted for Christmas.
Really? And what did he say?
Yeah, Mom, what did he say?
Well, we agreed to get you a man that's a board game you wanted, and you a land of that watch you wanted.
And because you girls are doing an excellent job and behaving well in school, we decided to get you something else with your gifts.
What are you guys getting us?
Yeah, please tell us.
Well, this will be a surprise. Since you know what the other gifts you're getting are, you can't just know all of them or else you won't have any fun opening your gifts up on Christmas Day.
Can you at least give us a hint?
The only hint you are getting is that things you need.
Are the gifts big or small?
You'll see.
Where can we use them?
In many places.
Are the gifts nice? Yes, they are.
What can they be?
You girls just have to wait and be patient.
Are you getting us a new iPod?
Okay, now you're asking for too much. And no, we will not tell you what you're getting. You will just have to wait until Christmas morning.
Okay.
Okay, just one more question. Are they clothes?
Maybe.
Okay, we will try to be patient and not ask too many questions.
Good. Now help me clean up the table. So what do you think Mom and Dad are getting us this Christmas?
Well, I'm not 100% sure, but I asked for those new pair of jeans and that t-shirt I've been dying to get.
Oh, I so want that coat, tirelessly, and the black shoes I told you about.
Well, Mom said that she'll see about what they get us.
Yeah, I really hope they get us what we asked for.
I overheard Mom and Dad talking. They said that they will probably get us what we want, but they don't want to tell us because they want to make sure we're doing well in school and getting those marks we promised to get.
So far, I've done all right. I just need to do well on my next math test, and I think I'll be set.
Yeah, me too. I still have to work on that science project that's taking me forever, but Mom said that she'll help me so I can finish faster.
I cannot wait for Christmas Day to open my gifts.
You and me both. Do you think we'll get lots of presents?
We just have to wait and see.
I'm counting down those days.
Guys, you would not believe what I'm getting for Christmas.
Clothes?
Nope.
A new iPod?
That's not it.
A phone?
Wrong again.
Then what is it, Kevin?
I am getting a new Xbox.
Oh, yeah, that's so cool. You're so lucky.
Yeah, that's cool.
What are you boys getting for Christmas?
Well, I'm hoping for a PS3.
I told my parents to get me the new BlackBerry.
Oh, you guys and your toys.
Hey, guys, what's up?
Oh, hey, girls, not much.
What are you guys talking about?
Oh, these boys are just telling us what they're getting for Christmas.
Oh, yeah, what are they getting?
Well, Kevin is getting the new Xbox. Andrew is getting the new PS3. And Adam is getting the new BlackBerry.
Oh, nice, guys.
They think they're the only ones getting nice gifts.
Yeah, seriously.
Oh, yeah, so what are you guys getting?
Well, besides the clothes I asked for, I'm getting the iPhone 5.
Oh, I'll be happy getting the iPad mini.
What about you, Emma?
Oh, this year my family and I are going on a cruise during Christmas. I can't wait. They told me I can pick a gift from our trip.
Oh, you're so lucky.
Where are you guys going?
Not sure, but my parents are looking into it. My cousins are coming too, so it's gonna be a whole lot of fun.
I bet.
These are all nice presents.
And what are you guys getting for Christmas?
Oh, just some clothes.
Yeah, I'm hopefully getting a wristlet and shoes.
How about you, Amanda and Alana?
Well, my parents are getting me this board game I've asked for, and I think some clothes.
Yeah, I'm getting a watch, and I think some clothes too.
Oh, those are not bad gifts.
Well, yeah, I guess.
They're all right.
Okay, guys, recess is almost over now.
Okay, let's go.
I need the chairs. Okay, Mom and Dad, what are they doing?
What's wrong, girls? Why the gloomy faces?
Yeah, you girls look really sad. What's the matter?
Nothing, Mom.
Yeah, nothing, Dad.
I agree with your mom. How about you, Amanda and Lena? Why don't you tell us?
Well, I guess it's not a big deal.
Yeah, don't worry about it, Mr. and Mrs. Jones.
Okay, we are not leaving you girls before someone tells us why you girls are so sad.
Well, we were walking at recess at school today.
And what happened?
A bunch of our friends were standing and talking, so we joined them.
Uh-huh.
We were talking about what we were getting for Christmas and stuff.
And is that what's making you sad?
Well, no.
Then what? Okay, we all heard what their parents are getting them for Christmas.
And what are they getting?
One's getting an Xbox.
The other one's getting a PS3.
Adam's getting the new BlackBerry.
And what else?
Daniela's getting the iPhone 5 and Samantha's getting the iPad mini. And Emma's family is going on a cruise and they told her she can pick a gift while they are there.
I think I know this is going.
I think I do too. But I want you girls to tell us why this whole thing is getting to you.
Well, the four of us were talking about it afterwards.
And we envied them and wished we were getting the cool stuff they're getting.
Well, let me ask you girls a question.
Sure, what's your question, Dad?
Knowing what all you girls are getting and they are what you ask for and you're happy of getting them until you learned what your friends were getting.
Unfortunately, the way that we see things makes us want what others have.
But it's not that way. We just like the stuff they're getting.
Yeah, we think their stuff are cool and we'd like to have their stuff as well.
So we don't appreciate what we have, but we focus on what people around us have.
Many examples from the Bible comes to my mind, but one in particular I'm focused on. Can you wait a second while I go get my Bible and read it to you?
Sure, Mom.
It is in the parable of the workers in the vineyard. It's in Matthew chapter 20, starting in verse 1. Let me read it to you. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. Now, when he had agreed with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into his vineyard. And he went out about the third hour and saw others standing idle in the marketplace and said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and whatever is right, I will give you." So they went. Again, he went out about the sixth and the ninth hour and did likewise. And about the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing idle and said to them, "Why have you been standing here idle all day?" And they said to him, "Because no one hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and whatever is right, you will receive." So when evening had come, the owner of the vineyard said to his steward, "Call the laborers and give them their wages, being with the last to the first." And when those came who were hired about the 11th hour, they each received a denarius. But when the first came, they supposed that they would receive more. And they likewise each received a denarius. And when they had received it, they complained against the landowner, saying, "These last men have worked only 1 hour, and you made them equal to us, who have been borne the burden and the heat of day." But he answered one of them and said, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what is yours and go your way. I wish to give these last men the same as to you. Is it not lawful for me to do what I wish with my own things? Or is your eye evil because I am good?" In this parable, the workers knew what they were getting, and they agreed to it. But when they saw that the last man worked only 1 hour and got the same amount of money, it soured them.
You see, the whole thing was, instead of being happy and content with what they got, which was what they had been promised, all the joy got sucked out of them.
And it got replaced with envy and discontentment. You see, all that we have comes from God. No matter what it is, we don't own it, and therefore we fail to see the generosity of God with the things that we have. Because it is not about the actual gift itself, but it is about having to appreciate it.
And the awful thing about envy is that we get no pleasure in what God has done for us, has gave us, unless we focus on what he gives us and gives thanks for it.
We see others with gifts that we don't have, and they see us with gifts that they don't have. But that is not what we think about.
Don't concentrate on differences, but concentrate on what God has done for us and be grateful for it.
We can all at some point get really cool and exciting gifts, but we keep forgetting the most important gift of all, the gift that God gave us, and that is his son, Jesus Christ.
We can keep asking for more and more, but nothing satisfies us other than accepting the precious gift in our lives.
And we should remember this every day of our lives, but most importantly around Christmas, because that is when Jesus was born and came into the world to save us. And that should be the only source of our joy, because everything else will not last anyways.
Wow, I was really selfish and just thought about the stuff I wanted.
Yeah, I can't believe we felt that way. I guess you cannot be content when you look at others.
Look at what envy can do to a person. It makes you lose all your joy.
Yeah, I was just thinking in a jealous way, which brought me down, and I lost the true meaning of Christmas.
Thanks, Mom. Thanks, Dad, for helping us see clearly.
Yeah, thanks for bringing us back to our joy.
Thank you, Mr. and Mrs. Jones, for helping us not lose focus.
This really opened our eyes to many things we shall be aware of. Thank you from the bottom of our heart.
No need to thank us, girls. We are glad that you get to the point and are happy again.
Yes, you don't need to thank us, but thank God for being in our lives and continuing to bless us with great things each and every day in our lives.
And that brings us to the end of our play.
We really hope you enjoyed watching it.
We pray that we all be reminded of most important gift God gave us, and that his son Jesus Christ.
And now let us all focus on him and him alone, and not any other gift that we get.
Have a blessed and Merry Christmas, everyone.
So what we have next is actually a song. It's called Winter Wonderland by Ayla.
Matthew, nice job for making fun of Alex. He's such a loser.
Loser only? He's a weirdo.
Duh, that's why all teachers like him.
He's such a chicken, and he doesn't even defend himself.
He thinks by doing that he's being a good Christian.
He's too weak to defend himself. Anyways, we got him good this time. That's all that matters. Come on, let's go find somebody else to pick on.
Sounds like a plan. Let's go.
I told you, Farrah, that Matthew and his friends are bad people, and you never believe me.
Well, I didn't know he was such a bully until I saw what he did to you.
I felt so little. I just wanted to leave from this church.
Leave church?
I have made up my mind. I'm not going to Sunday school anymore. As a matter of fact, I'm not even going to church.
Why? What happened, Alex?
His friends are being mean to him for no reason.
People in church are all fake, and they're not better than people outside of the church.
I'm getting convinced with that, too.
I would be careful making such a statement, my dears.
Grandma, have you seen our friends in church? They behave exactly the same outside of church. What's the difference?
That's the truth, Grandma. Admit it.
So are you going to tell me what happened?
Only if you don't take their side.
I promise I will only listen.
Well, after Mass was over, we were playing outside. Then Matthew came and told everyone that I have no friends in school and that nobody wants to be around me. That I'm not as cool as the rest. I'm shorter than the guys in my class. I'm not as physically strong. I'm not as handsome. And top of that, I'm a nerd. And that's why teachers like me. Everyone started laughing at me. They made jokes and I felt so little. I have every right to be angry and upset. As a matter of fact, I'm paying him back. I don't know exactly what I'm gonna do next.
Alex, you have every right to be upset at what Matthew did because he was bullying you.
So you agree with us, Grandma?
I understand your feelings.
What do you suggest I do?
I think we should watch the following scenes, and then you can make up your mind on what you want to do.
I got an iPad for my birthday from my parents.
That's so cool. I've always wanted one. Can I play with it?
You can only play with it if you are very careful with it. I just got it last week.
I will.
Oops, sorry.
Oh no, my iPad.
You broke Dima's iPad?
I'm so sorry.
You broke my iPad.
The kids pushed me and I dropped it. I didn't mean to break it.
I told you to be careful with it. I knew I shouldn't have trusted you with it.
I told you you should have given it to me to play with and not Natalie. I would have been more careful. I feel bad. How can I make it up to you?
What am I going to do with your apology? You can't do anything for me now. Just leave me alone. I don't want to talk to you anymore.
It's too late to do anything for Dima. You can't fix it, and you don't have the money to get her another one.
Please don't be upset at me. I'll do anything you want.
I told you to leave me alone. I don't want to be your friend anymore.
Why are you being like that? She apologized to you. She didn't mean to break it.
What? Don't you understand? This is my iPad that I got for my birthday. I've been waiting for this gift for such a long time, and now it's broken.
Natalie didn't break it on purpose. Besides, she's your friend.
She's no longer my friend, and I don't want to be her. I don't want to talk to her anymore.
Well, if you won't forgive her, you will lose her as a friend.
So let it be. I don't care.
So harsh, Grandma. Natalie apologized to Dima, and she still doesn't want to forgive her.
I'm afraid her iPad is more important than her friendship. Let's continue watching.
Come on, Janelle, don't cry. It's not the end of the world.
It's even worse when you trust somebody so much, and they turn out to be not trustworthy.
What do you mean? What happened?
Nancy completely betrayed me. She went and told the whole world my secrets after I told her not to share them with anyone.
Why'd she do that?
Because she's not a good friend. She's so evil. I shouldn't have trusted her with anything. She's full of herself and just wanted to hurt me. She backstabbed me, and I'm going to pay her back. I'm going to tell the whole world who she has a crush on, how she lies to her parents, skips school, cheats on exams, and much more.
Why are you being like this?
She did the same to me. She deserves to be treated the same way.
But the Bible doesn't teach us an eye for an eye.
Well, I don't care. Don't start preaching at me now. Wake up. This is reality.
If I talk to Nancy and tell her what she did was wrong and that she really hurt you and should come and apologize, would that make you feel any better?
No.
Why not?
Because I will not talk to her again.
What if she apologizes?
I will not accept her apology and I'll never trust her again.
What are you going to do about it?
I'm going to write all her secrets down so I won't forget any. Then share them with the whole church.
What's the point of that?
Just to make you feel what I feel.
So you want to revenge?
That's the only way that's going to make me feel better.
I think that's going to make you feel even worse.
I have the right to do whatever I want, and nobody has the right to tell me anything, including you.
We're just trying to advise you to do the right thing as a Christian.
I told you, I don't want you to preach at me. I have the right to do whatever I want.
Well, if I share a similar story with you that happened to me, would that make you feel better?
What's your story?
Remember Joy from grade 5?
What about her?
We used to be best friends and always hang out together, but not anymore.
What happened?
She talked behind my back, and when she heard that I found out, she came to apologize.
And what did you do?
You know me, I have a good heart. Of course I accepted her apology, how could I not? You know, as being a Christian, we have to forgive one another. But to be honest with you, and this is between the three of us, I can't stand her guts.
I don't blame you.
My day gets ruined every time I see her. I try to avoid her as much as I can. I distance myself from her to keep it very formal between us. I can't stand seeing or dealing with her. But other than that, I've forgiven her.
Well, I can't forgive, and I'll make her pay back for what she has caused me.
Well, I think you shouldn't revenge, but it's your choice. I have to go. My mom's making dinner. Bye.
I second that opinion, but it's your decision anyways. See you later.
It's my fault for trusting people. I should have never trusted anyone. I learned my lesson the hard way. From now on, I will not trust anyone because at the end of the day, nobody cares about anybody else but themselves. So why should I care about others? I have to be tough and strong with others and never share any of my weaknesses. I will only hang around people that will benefit me and those that have something to offer me. Otherwise, they don't deserve to be around me.
Grandma, I don't understand how Christine forgives her friend, but at the same time, she can't stand her.
It looks like Janelle is up to no good with her revenge, and her attitude towards other people is getting quite stinky.
She is becoming very self-centered and arrogant.
I don't think she truly forgave her friend, but let's continue watching.
So that concludes our message for this Sunday. Please remember to memorize your lines for the Christmas play next Sunday. Before you leave, can someone please pray for us? Dima, can you pray?
But Miss K, I don't know what to pray.
Can I pray instead of Dima?
No, Dima is going to pray. Just say your own prayer.
I'm just going to say the Our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
Amen.
Miss Kate, can I please talk to you?
Sure.
Well, when I was playing the Our Father, I stumbled on, "Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespassed against us."
Yeah, I noticed that. You repeated that verse 3 times.
But what does it mean?
It means we are asking God to forgive our sins, just like we forgive each other's sins.
Does that mean I have to forgive those who do wrong to me?
The Bible says if we forgive men that sin against us, then our Heavenly Father will forgive us our sins. But if we don't forgive men that sin, then your Father won't forgive you your sins. It's a condition. In order for God to forgive you your sins, you will have to forgive your brothers and sisters' sins.
That's easy for God to forgive. He's God. I can't forgive those who do wrong to me. It's just impossible.
God forgives. Actually, when you think of it, it's the other way around.
What do you mean?
God is the perfect one who chose to forgive the imperfect, and that's humanity. He did that when he sent his only begotten son to the world to forgive our sins. As we celebrate Christmas, we are being reminded of the gift of Christmas, God-given gift, and that is forgiveness of sins from salvation from eternal judgment.
Does that mean God forgives everyone for everything?
No, God only forgives those who come to him admitting that they are sinners in need of his forgiveness, repenting from their sins. But remember, forgiveness is a gift. When you receive it, you are to share it with others. I'll leave you to go for communion now.
Thanks, Miss Kay. I guess I was wrong for not forgiving Natalie for breaking my iPad. Sorry, God, for being rude and unforgiving to Natalie and holding grudges towards her in my heart. Grant me to always forgive those who do wrong to me.
I'm forgiven, cause you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again.
I guess it's just an iPad, and at the end of the day, I enjoy playing with you, and my friendship with you is more important to me than an iPad.
What is this? Are these angels? Who are you?
We are messengers sent from God to deliver this message to you two.
I know I'm a good Christian. I go to Sunday school every Sunday, memorize my verses, pray before I go to bed, and I don't swear. What compliments does God have for me?
All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. He who has broken one commandment has broken the law and requires God's forgiveness. The Lord has closed everybody under sin, that by his grace he may save all those who repent and ask for his forgiveness.
I haven't broken any commandments.
You have not forgiven the joy of what she did.
Of course I did. I even told her I forgave her.
God examines the heart and sees the unforgiveness in your heart towards joy. The Lord commands for you to bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. Your prayers shall not be answered if you hold anything against anyone. That is the message I have from the Most High for you.
I think you have the wrong address. This message can't be for me.
As for you, Janelle, the Lord says it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. You are not called to revenge, but to compassionate, merciful, kind, and forgiving to others as the Lord has been to you.
You have experienced the many times the Lord saved you from troubles, was merciful to you when you should be punished, and forgave you when you were wrong. You received his gift of forgiveness, and his message to you now is just like you receive, you ought to give. You have received generously and freely, and now it's your turn to give generously to your brothers and sisters, for you are called to be like the image of his son.
Angels, with all my respect to you, but you don't understand how hurt I am from Nancy. You're angels, and you've never experienced what I'm experiencing right now, so you can't relate to what I'm going through.
The message we are giving you is not from us. As I told you earlier, we are messengers only. The one that sent us knows, feels, and understands what you're going through.
For it is written, because he himself suffered when he is tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. We have to go now for another mission, but I warn you not to take the Lord's word lightly.
You know, these angels are all wrong. I think they misunderstood what God told them. I think they got the wrong address. I don't think they're bright enough to be angels.
They're like mail persons, just do delivery and have no idea of the contents of the message, nor understand the situation of the person receiving the message.
And how many times do you get your neighbor's mail?
All the time!
I'm just going to dismiss this message because it obviously does not apply to me.
I'm kind of bothered by what they said.
Well, I'm just going to dismiss it because it doesn't apply to me.
Yeah, I think I'll just ignore them because they're just out to lunch.
Let's go to the mall and continue our shopping. Woohoo!
Let's go.
Grandma, I can't believe what I'm seeing before my own eyes.
So what is surprising you?
How can they simply dismiss the message from the angels?
This was a message from God to them. They didn't even believe. They didn't even believe them. They just kept giving excuses, didn't listen, and on top of that, they made the angels look like they didn't know what they were doing.
My dears, that's the human nature, the corrupt nature that is self-righteous, self-centered, unloving, unforgiving, rebellious, and selfish that Jesus came down to save. Remember, Jesus was born to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of sins.
This sinful nature is not worth being saved. It deserves to be in hell.
Thank God for his unconditional love and mercy that he sent his son to forgive us while we are still sinners and to free us from the bondage of sin.
So what happens to those who don't accept his forgiveness?
Simply, they don't enjoy this gift and they can't share it with others, for they can't share something they don't have. And that's really scary for them, because when they don't accept his forgiveness, they are still under his judgment.
What about those who receive the gifts from God of forgiveness, but they don't share it with others, like Janelle and Christine?
They will have bitter roots in their hearts that will grow into a big tree, carrying fruits of envy, jealousy, and bitterness towards so many people. They will not be at peace with themselves, nor with God, because of unforgiveness.
So what you're saying, they will lose out on enjoying the peace and comfort that God gives when we forgive?
That's right, you got it.
We all saw that when Dima forgave Natalie, she was a lot more joyful and peaceful with herself and people all around her.
She listened to the voice of God that came to her when she was praying the Our Father and acted on it. She didn't deny it or dismiss it like the other two.
The other two had angels appear to them, but they didn't even believe them. What else can make them believe?
Nothing. They had set their minds not to listen and did not want to be convicted of their unforgiving hearts by the Holy Spirit. You saw the actions of Dima, Christine, and Janelle. Now it's your decision to make as to how you want to act with Matthew.
Well, I want to listen to the voice of God at all times and live a pleasing life to him. I forgive him totally. But I think I should go to him in person and tell him I don't appreciate what he's doing and ask him to stop bullying me.
I support you on that decision. That's my boy, and I am so proud of you.
So next we have Kathy, and she's going to be singing a song.
Silent night, holy.
A round of applause for Zane and Daniel. So this next play is actually very special, and it's Diana's class, the grades 7 and 8. So the children came together this year to create a play regarding the fear of the end of the world due to the Mayan calendar. And it turns out there's actually a small village in Quebec, which CBC broadcasted, showing a man who took advantage of the Mayan myth, and he created an event at his restaurant called an end of the world meal. And this actually offended all the villagers because they were actually afraid that the world is ending. And you'll see this depicted in their play, but I want you to pay a lot of attention to this because the kids actually came up with the play on their own.
There's a heaven after earth. How do you know that there's a God out there when all these bad things are happening in the world? 20 children dying in Connecticut. Where's your God in all of this?
Oh, how I wish I can fall asleep. I keep on having these bad thoughts every night, over and over again. Like, how do we know there's a God out there? What if the world ends tonight? Where will I go? Is there a heaven or a hell? Do other religions take me to God too? Well, at least that's what my religion teacher says. But what about the Bible? Is it true? Not according to my religion teacher. They're just stories for good morals. And it didn't really happen. So what am I supposed to believe in? How am I supposed to know the truth? Oh God, please help me. I can't go to sleep.
Julie, let's manimti.
I keep on having these bad thoughts that come to my mind about the end of the world, God, and going to heaven. I can't go to sleep. Can you help me?
Zen. How would I tell you how great and mighty our God is, and...
Are you sure?
Well, how about we start with when the people of God wanted to cross the Red Sea. Pharaoh and his army were following them into the desert, but God with his mighty hand opened up the sea and let his people pass through. Our God is so great that he can move the mountains and calm the seas. He made the whole world with his word, and all things are possible through him.
Can you tell me more? What about Jesus?
The same God that created the whole universe can do all things and has a heart filled with love towards his creation. God loved us so much that he gave us his only son to save us. Jesus is the love of God revealed in its fullness to us. My dear daughter, Jesus is always with you. He sends his guardian angels to protect you. And he will never forsake you.
Thank you, Mom. I think I can go to sleep now. Good night.
Good night, Habibi.
Hey, I hope you had a good sleep last night, since today's a big day.
What big day?
Didn't you hear, or are you just too afraid to think about it?
Or maybe she's just scared to go to hell. Ha, ha, ha.
Come on, who wants to go to heaven anyway? It's a boring place. People singing and praying, not much fun to spend eternity.
You're right. So that makes hell a fun place since everybody's going there.
Well, I don't think anybody's going to go to heaven except for saints. And clearly, we're not saints.
I want to go to heaven. I don't mind the singing and the praying. At least I'm far away from the devil.
Oh, and since when were you a saint, Mr. Religious?
Why are you so frightened about the end of the world anyway? The teacher said that we are all good people, and if we sin, God is good. He won't send us to hell.
So just relax and enjoy your last day of life.
But Jesus said that he's going to take those who believe in him.
So are you saying that only the Bible is correct?
That is so narrow-minded. What about all the other religions? Are you saying they're going to go to hell? That is so hard to believe that God's going to send the rest of the world to go to hell.
Okay, you got me confused now. Is there a heaven or hell to start with? No. Maybe there's nothing. no God, no end of the world to start with?
Come on, let's go to class and see what the teacher has to say about this.
Welcome, class. Let me just take attendance. Rita?
Here.
Maria?
Here.
Daniel?
Here.
Julie?
Here.
Hannah?
Here.
Matthew?
Here.
And let us welcome our new student, Rafi.
Welcome.
Welcome here.
Welcome, Rafi.
Well, Rafi.
So, welcome to another fun class of religion.
Fun until the world ends.
What did you say? Can you say that with the rest of the class, please?
Well, miss, I was just wondering if it would be fun if the world ended tonight.
Well, I'm not sure if the end of the world comes tonight or not, but if it does, I am sure that the Lord will take us because he is good and he loves us all. So, to answer your question, yes, it will be fun. Now, continue with our lessons about religion. Last lesson, we talked about a number of religions and what they believe in.
So, miss, do all religions believe in God?
As I explained before, each religion has their own traditions and beliefs, and they all want to lead to God. But because people are different, they have different ways of going to God and understanding God. But they all want to lead to God. Yes?
Miss, I have a question. If each religion contradicts each other, how can they lead to the same God when they have totally different teachings and stories about God?
Well, we may have different interpretations of what religions say in their book and what it really means. Also, there may be different heavens with different religions in them, but there are no wrong or right ones. I don't get why you're so confused about this.
But miss, I did not say that. I mean, Jesus said in the Bible, he is the way of the truth and life, and no one goes through the Father except through me. So how can other religions go to God except for Jesus?
Are you sure that God said that in the Bible? Maybe he meant to say something else. I am sure that God loves us all, and he wouldn't mean to exclude any other religions because they're different. I am sure that God loves us. At this point, let us close the discussion because it's going nowhere. And Julie, you need to reconsider your beliefs and to accept all religions. Class dismissed.
Yay.
Just take it easy and stop worrying about all the other religions. Just be a good person and have fun for your last day.
Yeah, and what difference does it make to you anyways?
See you tomorrow, either in school or in hell.
Oh my Lord. I thought I had no doubts and fears after that last night, but now I'm even more confused. I'm confused about my faith, what my parents have taught me, what I've learned in Sunday school. Is it all wrong and narrow-minded? Are these teachers wrong? What about the Bible? Is it true or not? Maybe these beliefs can be even worse. But Lord, I am so scared. What about the Bible? I don't understand this anymore. Can you please help me? I need to stop doubting you, and I need to stop being afraid. I'm so sorry. Who are you?
I am your Savior, Jesus. You called out my name today. I've come to show you the way. Why are you crying?
The end of the world is coming tonight at 9 p.m. I am so scared. I don't want to go to hell.
How do you know when the world will end? No one knows when it will happen except for my Father in heaven. No. Not even the angels in heaven know.
It's all over the news. You mean the whole world knows, except for the angels? That does not sound right.
Listen to me, daughter. If you want to hear the truth, the world does not know what it is saying, for it does not know me or my word. I am the word of God that came down from heaven. I am the light of the world. He who believes in me shall not be in the darkness.
Speak, Lord, so that I am your servant. I want to be in the light. I want to know the truth. I don't want to doubt you anymore.
In your life, you will be tempted to doubt me. But if you believe in me and my word, you will not doubt me.
Speak, Lord, that I am your servant. Well, that's what I learned at Sunday school.
First, let me remind you of a very old story. It's the first story that happened after creation, yet it repeats every day. The story of Adam and Eve.
Now the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat of it, you will surely die." Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord had made.
Did God really say you must not eat of any tree in the garden?
We may eat the fruit in the garden, but we may not touch it or we will die.
You will not surely die, for God knows that if you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.
The woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom. She took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her and he ate it.
As you see, the serpent tempted Eve to doubt and disbelieve God's word. He gave her a lie and she believed it instead of believing God's word. Listen to me, daughter. The devil is a murderer, not holding to the truth, for he has no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of all lies. He will always tempt you to doubt me, but if you believe in me and my word, you will not doubt me. But if you believe in him and his lies, you will start to doubt your faith.
What if I have many questions and I need proof to believe?
Well, this is what happened to my disciple Thomas.
I just can't get over what happened last week.
Oh, that was a glorious moment when Jesus appeared to us.
My heart was filled with fear and sadness when Jesus died. I would have never thought the awaited Messiah would be crucified.
But he is risen, and he has appeared to all of us that night. So we are not afraid and filled with hope and joy.
Remember when he came in and said peace, when all the doors were closed, and said peace be with you?
That's when peace entered my heart. A wonderful moment. A moment that will last my whole life.
Thomas, we have truly seen the Lord.
But yes, Thomas, he was right in front of our eyes, and I wish that you could see what we saw.
Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where his nail marks were, I will not believe.
Peace be with you, Thomas. Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out and put your hand on my side. Stop doubting and start believing.
My Lord and God,
because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not yet seen and have still believed.
I've only heard one song. You've only heard one song.
That's why I came to you today, so you could stop doubting and start believing.
I promise I will never doubt you, Lord.
Just keep your eyes on me and my word every day. That will keep you from doubting, from believing the devil's lies and doubting your faith.
I don't get it. Thank you, Lord. For now, I have no more doubts. Now I'm strong with you. But Lord, I'm still so afraid about the end of the world. What is going to happen to me? My family? I'm so scared what's going to happen. I don't want to go to hell.
For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Whoever believes in the Son shall not perish, but he who rejects the Son shall not see life, for God's wrath remains on him. My daughter, do not let your heart be troubled. Just trust in me and also in God, for my Father's house has many rooms. If it were not so, I would have already told you. I came to this world so I could take you with me so that you will also be where I am.
So all I have to do is believe in you and I'll go to heaven? Is it that simple?
Yes, daughter. I came to the world to die on the cross and I also resurrected so that I would pay the price for your sin. By grace you are saved through faith, but not through works. You are... No one will boast. Since Adam and Eve disbelieved God, sin entered the world and separated God from humanity. Death and suffering spread through all the generations. The world has been waiting for a Savior to come and forgive them for their sins.
Do not be afraid, for I bring good news of great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born. He is Christ the Lord. You will find them lying in a manger and wrapped in cloths.
Glory to you, God in the highest, and on earth peace to him on whom his favor rests.
Wow, what an amazing scene. I can't believe my eyes.
The great news of the Messiah given to us shepherds, how great is our God that he gave the greatest news to unworthy people like us.
I was so terrified to see the angels, but then I was filled with joy and excitement to see the Christ.
Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that is happening, which the Lord has told us to do.
Let's go.
Oh my gosh.
My first coming was glorious and joyful for those who believe. I came as a humble baby to save the world. But my second coming, will come as a glorious and victorious king and take my people with me to heaven, all those who have believed. Daughter, do you truly believe that I am God, the Son of God, the Savior of the world?
I believe you are my Lord and my Savior.
Then you will rejoice with all the believers that have also believed in me. As you celebrate my first coming on Christmas Day, just like the shepherd did and awaited it with fear and joy.
Look, Jesus, it's past 9 p.m. The world didn't end. I wish the world ended right now so that I had the last minutes on earth with you and the rest of eternity in heaven with you.
I am always with you from now until the end of time.
But for now, I want to learn more about you, Lord.
Behold me. Behold the Word. I am the Word of God that came down from heaven. Look in your drawer.
All this took place is to fulfill what the Lord has said through the prophet. The virgin will be with the child and will give birth to the son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Amen, Jesus. I believe your word.
You are my Emmanuel, God with me. Thank you for showing me the way and taking all my doubts and fears away. I will celebrate Christmas rejoicing that you came to this earth to save us from sin and death. And I will wait for your coming with rejoicing and praising because you will take me and go to heaven. Good night, Jesus.
Show is actually a really nice skit by the grades 9 and up, and it's Sarah's class, so I'd like you guys to really pay attention. I really appreciate that you've been paying attention this whole time.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand. Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God.
Mom and non-believers.
Yeah.
So like the
we
mom,
said,
mom,
no, his mom wasn't a believer. No.